Earth. Our planet is many extreme environments, ranging from Arctic deserts to high altitudes. Organisms that inhabit these areas must adapt in order to cope with these seemingly unlivable conditions. But where there's nature, there's a way, and through natural selection, evolution leads to physiological changes that make living in extreme environments possible. The fascinating environment we have chosen to delve deeper into is known as brine pools. In this presentation, we will investigate animals that reside in close contact to these extreme areas and the physiological adaptations that allow them to do so. But what actually are brine pools? Brine pools are characterised by their extremely high saline concentration, around 3 to 8 times more than surrounding water. This creates an area of water so dense with salt that it can be challenging to even penetrate. This clear distinction in appearance compared to the surrounding water leads to it often being referred to as an underwater lake, which can range in sizes from a few metres to many kilometres. How are they formed? In simple terms, these pools are formed when ancient salt deposits leach into the ocean. But let's go into more detail with an example of how these extraordinary salt lakes are created. Here we're going to look at a specific example of popular brine pools which are formed in the Gulf of Mexico. But to understand its formation more clearly, we need to turn the clock back near 200 million years to the Jurassic period. At this point in time, the area was cut off from the rest of the ocean and was much shallower. Because of this, over time the salinity of the water grew. When the water eventually evaporated, it left behind large quantities of salt along the seafloor, creating an astounding layer of 8 kilometres deep. Over time, as the continents moved apart through the shifting of tectonic plates, this both stretched the Gulf region over a wider area, significantly lowering the seafloor, and introduced an opening to the ocean. This resulted in it again being filled with water. Over the time period it took for the Gulf to form into an ocean, sediments had formed a blanket over the layer of salt which prevented it from dissolving. With water, however, comes additional sediment, and so deposits were continuously made, submerging the salt even deeper. Finally, the pressure of the above sediment becomes too much and physically crushes the layer of salt, disrupting it and causing it to move underneath. This process is referred to as salt tectonics. What results from this process is domes forming, where streams of salt move above the top layers of sediment, breaking out the seafloor. When this contact is made with seawater, the salt is dissolved and the formation of a localised hypersaline pool of water is created, also known as brine pools. So what makes these pools so extreme to live amongst? Brine pools have a variety of features that can make encounters with them deadly. For one, they're anoxic, which means they don't have any oxygen. So when an organism attempts to respirate as normal, they experience what is known as cerebral hypoxia. On top of this, due to the extreme salinity of the environment, the individual will go into toxic shock. Additionally, some brine pools contain deadly elements such as hydrogen sulfate, which inhibits cellular respiration and damages the nervous system, meaning that most passerbyers, if caught in the pool, have very little chances of survival. So why are there still even a small variety of species who live in the midst of this death trap? Although no animals can live directly in the brine pool, a variety of species are able to live in the interface region between the pool and the seawater, which can be advantageous because many unfortunate animals die when entering the brine pool, whether it be by accident or on purpose. This leaves a honeypot of dead material that is sunk down to the base. This means that there's a rich food source available for any animals who are able to endure the conditions long enough in order to retrieve them. Another advantage is the unique chemistry produced by the brine pools. Like hydrogen sulfate and methane, this acts as a great source of nutrients for chemosynthetic microbiology. This allows the formation of a diverse and unique microbiome within the brine seawater interface. This is also attractive to filter feeding macrofauna. On the topic of microbiomes, Ewan will now go into more detail about cellular adaptations.
In high salinity, water rapidly leaves cells via osmosis. This causes the cell to shrink and the cytoplasm of the cell will condense, which in turn prevents the movement of cell organelles, impacting its ability to function, and it will eventually die. Cells will immediately try to combat this and are usually successful, but what if the salinity they were up against was 125% stronger than that of seawater? How would they cope? Research has found that a gene called LRRC8A plays a central role in the ability of cells to survive osmotic shock. It was found that this gene codes for a protein that forms channels in the cell membrane. These channels are activated when the cell is exposed to hypertonic conditions and allow cells to display regulatory volume increase, or RVI. These channels will pump chloride ions into the cells, causing various pathways to be activated that allow cells to intake water and return to the original state. One adaptation found in cells are gas vesicles. Found in some prokaryotes, they are thought to help with buoyancy. Certain prokaryotes found near brine pools possess an increased amount of these gas vesicles. It is thought that these may be used in the brine seawater interface to maintain a certain height above brine pools in the water, allowing these organisms to feed from nutrient-rich detritus found in the pools but prevent themselves from going into osmotic shock. A paper from Wang et al. Stated that another adaptation of microbiome is symbiotic relationships. Eukaryotes have been found that hold epi-symbiotic relationships with prokaryotes, which they use for exploration of food sources. However, the paper doesn't clearly state why or how this happens. Another recent discovery has been that of extremozymes. These are enzymes that exhibit extreme tolerances to cold, heat, acidity, and salinity. While it may be unclear how these enzymes show such tolerances, they are currently being studied as biocatalysts to make some industrial processes more green. Another adaptation, highlighted in a paper by Speth et al., discusses an Anammox bacteria in the Red Sea, which uses three different amino acids as compatible solutes to prevent osmotic shock. However, constantly producing these compatible solutes is more costly than simply using the salt intake strategy, so why do it? The paper suggests that it may be to adapt quickly to varying salt concentrations in and around the BSI, and I think it may be also used to prevent cell damage in the process of losing water before salt intake strategy takes effect. Another adaptation is extracellular hemoglobin, which may have originally been formed in detrimental processes such as hemolysis, but in the case of anoxic conditions of brine pools, this may have developed into more complex structures allowing its benefit. Now we'll hear from Leah for more about that and respiration in general.
I'm going to talk about respiratory adaptations of brine pools. A combination of sulfur and hypoxia conditions within the saturated sediments cause a major respiratory challenge in living organisms that live near or within the interphase region of a brine pool. The interphase of a brine pool is where there are significantly decreased oxygen levels and high levels of salinity. Therefore, in order to withstand these toxic conditions, many organisms must adapt in order to survive. I am now going to describe the different adaptations of polychaete worms that have thought to have adapted their respiratory capabilities. Examples of these polychaetes include the M. dendrobranchiates and the vestimentiferan, which are known as deep-sea tube worms. This diagram shows the normal function of a closed circulatory system in worms. These are found in less harsh environments, which is shown on the left diagram. On the right diagram shows that the structure of the gills differ. This adaptation of a large surface area helps them regulate the rate of oxygen consumption, as it takes more oxygen at a faster rate when it is needed. They also have high hemoglobin oxygen affinity. This means they can achieve a full loading of oxygen at a less expense for their tissues, as it overall has a better oxygen delivery function. I'm now going to look at the M. dendrobranchiate, which is a kind of polychaete. These individuals are adapted to having short diffusion distances across their gill epithelia. This allows them to receive oxygen at a faster rate. They also contain extracellular hemoglobin in the blood vessels. This allows them to carry oxygen more efficiently around the body. In the deep sea tube worms, they have a Bohr effect, which is present. This is where the hemoglobin binds to the oxygen in the lungs and efficiently releases the oxygen to the tissues. The effect also internally prioritizes tissues that need more oxygen compared to other tissues. If organisms enter a brine pool with no sufficient adaptation to their respiratory systems, this ultimately results in cerebral hypoxia. This is where there's a decrease in oxygen supply to the brain. This can cause severe damage. This can lead to either death in most organisms, which is shown in these pictures below. Due to this, the brine pools often get referred to as the jacuzzi of despair. They get this name because most organisms die when they become surrounded in the toxic fluid. I will now pass on to Adam, who will talk about osmoregulation adaptations.
Osmoregulation is highly important in such a hypersaline environment such as the brine pool interface. All species of macrofauna observed at the brine seawater interface are osmoconformers. No living osmoregulator has ever been observed in this environment. Hypersaline adaptations are incredibly important, especially to telos fish that are seen coming in and out of this interface to forage for food. What adaptations allow for the resilience to this hypersaline condition and minimize the effects of toxic shock? We see increased body salt concentrations in telos fish with higher salt concentrations of the environment around them. However, it is not proportional to the external salt concentration to a T. So, something else must be going on. Increased brachial sodium and potassium pumping is seen when going from an area of lower concentration of salt to an area of higher concentration. This has been applied to telos fish that go into the BSI to forage, such as the cutthroat eel. These fish have also been shown to increase their cortisol levels when doing so. It is unknown as to why they do this. The most numerous of species surrounding brine pools are bivalves, specifically mussels. Their morphology does differ between different levels of hypersalinity within the BSI. It shows that proportionally to their shells, they have smaller bodies except for their larger tinidium. This is probably due to the generalized filter feeding that they require in this environment and the increased respiratory needs in the low oxygen conditions. The smaller morphology has been attributed to the high salinity and the anoxic conditions. A decreased volume needed to be regulated osmotically. The physiological mechanisms required for osmoregulation in these extremophile species in the BSI environment is immensely understudied, and most studies focus on the behavioral osmoregulation rather than the physiological, which goes on to our section on behavioral adaptation with Sophie.
Different organisms within the brine pool will display different types of behaviours to help them survive the hypersaline conditions. Gastropod mollusks, commonly known as sea snails, can withstand a salinity up to 85 ppt. There are three main behaviours displayed by gastropod mollusks so they can survive in the brine pool. They can survive in the brine for many hours by closing their operculum. They will move upwards to keep them on top of the mussels where salinity is the lowest, and they will avoid entering water with salinity higher than 60. Polychaete worms perform aggregation behaviour. When this species is in large clumps, they will spread their collective surface across the tops of mussels to remain out the brine. However, these worms will die when water salinity reaches 75. Salinity tolerances do not explain the differences in distribution of these species. Gastropod mollusks are found in the outer layer of the brine pools, even though they can withstand higher salinities up to 85. And the polychaete worms are found in the inner layer of the brine pools, even though the salinity levels are higher here and they can only survive in levels under 75. But behaviour does play a very important role in salinity avoidance for both these species. Cutthroat eels are scavengers and will undergo foraging behaviour in search of something edible to eat. However, if they spend too long in the brine, they will go into cerebral hypoxia and then toxic shock. As you can see, this is very dangerous, but the eels must take this risk in order to survive. Thank you for listening. We hope you have learned about this extreme environment and how organisms have adapted to cope with the conditions.